Welcome to worship with St. Andrew's Lutheran Church of Grand Rapids, Minnesota. Glad that you can worship with us, those of you online, those of you in person. For those of you online, we are celebrating the Sacrament of Communion today. So if you'd like to participate, please gather bread and either wine or grape juice. Also, if you find yourself to be blessed by these ministries of ours, this online worship, and you would like to extend that blessing to others, please go to our website, and on that homepage, saintand.org, you'll find a donate button. You will make all things possible that we do here. That's what our contributions do. For all of us here in person, if you'd like to also support the ministries of this congregation, there are offering plates at the end of each of our aisles, and you too will be welcome to take part in communion, of course. Couple of announcements. One, greet one another. Those of you online, leave a comment for one another in the comments section. Those of you in house here, if you want to greet those who are worshiping online, go ahead, take your phone out and say welcome to worship and start a conversation online with that part of our congregation as well. A few announcements before we do begin. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we have middle school youth group with Nikki. Secondly, this coming Tuesday at 6 p.m., you are all invited to take part in a watch party, if you will. It's a Zoom webinar sponsored by our Northeastern Minnesota Synod EcoFaith Advocates team. The presentation is called What's So Different About Sulfide Mining? That will be right here in the sanctuary this Tuesday at 6:30. And then next Sunday, after worship, we'll gather in the north side of the fellowship hall, and we will have what we typically call the quarterly financial review or a budget review. And actually, we are a month beyond that, so I'll just say it's like our, first third of our fiscal year review. Our fiscal year changed this last year to July 1st, so we're just past 4 months into our fiscal year now. We try to do that. COVID kind of messed us up on the scheduling of that, but it's going to be a hybrid meeting. So for those of you particularly online right now, or if any of you are online next week, if you'd like to take part in that meeting, email the church office or me directly, and we'll provide you with a Zoom link so that you too can be part of that meeting. Today, our liturgy is being led by a group of instrumentalists and vocalists under the direction of Eileen Grossland, and you guys can come up right now because we are getting ready to begin. Everything you need will be on the screen in front of you. If you prefer to have the notes to the hymns, the hymn numbers are always listed if they come from our cranberry-colored hymnal. For example, the first one is number 774, What a Fellowship, What a Joy Divine. I invite you to stand.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leading on the everlasting arms. What a blessed as well.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Have mercy on us, O God.
We confess that we have sinned against you and against our neighbor. We have built walls instead of tables and have turned away the stranger. We have sought glory for ourselves and have treasured that which does not satisfy. Help us to love as you love, to welcome those you send, and to treasure mercy and justice. Turn us from our ways to your ways,
and free us to serve those in need. Amen.
Lord, have mercy. Kyrie eleison. God, who makes all things new, forgives you your sins for Jesus' sake and remembers them no more. Lift up your heads and your hearts. Yours is the kingdom of God.
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. To God in the highest.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Together, let us pray. Almighty God, your sovereign purpose brings salvation to birth. Give us faith to be steadfast amid the tumults of this world, trusting that your kingdom comes and your will is done through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, everybody. I think Pastor Dave always just gets a little bit nervous when I start bringing up props. So today, I want to talk to you and our friends at home about fear. It's not something we really like to talk about. We don't like to admit when we're scared of something. And we don't like to admit when we're worried about things. But, you know, change happens. What's the old saying? The only thing you can count on never to change is the fact that things will always change. Something like that. Anyway, a friend of mine, when I was on a mission trip with a whole bunch of high school youth, gave me a stress ball. And it's shaped like a roll, because we got it at the Home of the Throne Rolls, where they throw rolls across the restaurant. It's really awesome. You just hold your hand up and they just throw food at you. It's so cool. Anyway, she gave me this stress ball and it's been used. And then I also have this like rock that somebody gave me that kind of looks like a fish, and it's got a little dent in the middle because it's called a worry stone. So you can rub it and you can, you know, take your anxiety on that. People have fidget things. Do any of you guys have like a fidget thing where you can pop bubbles or you can click stuff? And it's supposed to help with anxiety or fear or worry. But I think that a lot of times we forget what the main thing that we can do to help us with fear and worry is, and that's prayer. And so I was gonna see if maybe Lincoln could come up and help me. I don't think there's any other kids younger here. Okay, so Lincoln, you're gonna give me a little bit of assistance here. Everybody say hi, Lincoln. You think this is a scary prop? Wait till you see what's left. All right, so we are going to do some pretending. And don't let it worry you that I have a big thing here just in case it doesn't work. Okay? I was telling Pastor Dave, no, I practiced this. 3 out of 5 times it worked. Okay, so we're going to pretend that your glass here is you, and this, I'm gonna put a little bit of water in it. This is a worry that you have. Now, Lincoln, is there anything that scares you? Like for me, I'm really, and everybody knows it's scared of cockroaches. Hey, cockroaches, I'm sorry, but I just don't like them. Is there anything that scares you?
A little bit of the dark.
Okay, so since it's the dark, we'll use a little bit of blue food coloring. Whoops, hope that didn't get on your shirt. And swirl it around, just kind of swirl it. Okay, so show everybody your blue. Now that's symbolizing Lincoln's fear of the dark. I want you to pour it in here. All of it, there you go. And then I'll take that cup from you, because fear's done. Yeah, sorry, that's not gonna come off anytime soon. What's something else that you are a little bit scared of? Sharks. Sharks are a good one. Luckily, we don't have to worry about them too much here in Minnesota, but still, a worthy fear. So here's your fear of sharks. Which should we put, green or yellow or red in? I guess I only have yellow. Yellow or green?
Green.
All right. I'll do it more carefully this time because we're both really messy right now. Okay. Swirl that around. Okay. Now pour that into our vessel here. Now, we had blue, and then we added green, and now it's kind of like a dark greenish black. It changed, right? Because every time we add something into our fears, it changes us a little bit. It makes us question and wonder and maybe even be just a little bit. You got the green on you, too. I'm so sorry, Shauna. It's only on his hands. It hasn't hit him yet in the clothing area. Okay, so we're going to do one more. Can you think of one more fear you might have? Putting him on the spot. Boy, that's specific. He's afraid of his dog turning into the devil. Being that I have a devil dog, I understand that fear. So we're going to use... Hello. I love you. Okay, yellow. Okay, swirl that around. Let's see what it does, if it makes any changes to our already concoction of fears. Yeah, I think now it's turning even more black, right? So fear, when we combine, this is all your fear, right here in this jar. Can you... I know, it's scary, right? You want to hold it? You want to hold your fears all at once? Okay, that's done. And... So I'm going to pretend that this plastic lid that I had on my pretzels at home is prayer. Okay? Everybody say one for me right now. So if I have prayer and I have fear, come on. See, prayer can stop our fear from running out all over the place. It worked. And I want you to think of all this space in here. That's all the Holy Spirit. It's with you all the time, even when you're scared. And that is not going to last for very long, so I'm going to do this. But prayer is better than a stress ball. It's better than a worry stone. It's better than almost anything. Prayer helps our fears, right? And let's pray, shall we? Will you stay up here while I pray with you? Okay. Will everybody join me in prayer? Dear God. Thank you for Lincoln. Thank you for friends. Thank you for family. Thank you for never ever leaving us. We need you. And in your name we pray. Amen. Thanks, Lincoln. Did you see how fast he couldn't wait to get out of here?
Our first reading today is from Psalm 16. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are the noble, in whom is all my delight. Those who choose another god multiply their sorrows. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out, or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body also rests secure. For you do not give me up to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The word of the Lord. Our next reading is from Hebrews 10, 11 through 25, with a lot of commas. So, and every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us. For after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 13th chapter. As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. But this is but the beginning of the birth pangs." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Thinking about this text that I just shared with you this morning, I've had a song running through my mind all week long, running through repeatedly. It's actually this song. At that point in his career, that was John Cougar Mellencamp. Not John Mellencamp, or not Johnny Cougar either. John Cougar Mellencamp, "When the Walls Come A-Tumbling Down." And I think you can understand why I was thinking about this song, not just because I was being nostalgic for, the 80s or something like that, but because this text is about destruction. It's about the temple coming down. So Jesus and his disciples, and we have to remember that his disciples are country bumpkins from up north, and they're down south to the big city of Jerusalem. And they're looking at the sites, and they are in awe now of this temple. It's so huge, it's so beautiful, it is majestic, impressive. And more so than just the edifice, the temple represented the very presence of God. If they had the temple, so to speak, they had God in the middle of the temple. Right in the middle of the temple, there was this space called the Holy of Holies, and that's where God was thought to reside. Again, as long as they had the temple with the Holy of Holies in Jerusalem, the people felt they had God. God was with them. Well, in the midst of all of that, Jesus shocked the disciples when he said that it would all be thrown down. Not one stone will be left upon another. When the walls come a-tumbling down. When the walls come a-tumbling down is an image of chaos. It's an image of struggle. It's an image of drastic change. It's an image of scary times. We all know what that feels like, don't we? Our entire world can be turned upside down in just a moment. Ask anyone who's experienced the death of a loved one. Ask anyone who's gotten bad news about cancer. Ask anyone who's lost a job because of the economy. Ask anyone who's had to call 911 for someone. Ask anyone who's gotten a call to go to the ER because their spouse is on their way in an ambulance. Ask anyone who's been diagnosed with COVID or who has a loved one who's been diagnosed that way. When there are no ICU beds available and they need critical care, life can be cruel to us and the walls can come a tumbling down. As I was reflecting on this the other day, I read a news release from the Itasca County Public Health Department. It began, "There are no more open beds for critical patients in Itasca County at this point, and nowhere to send those who need one when the walls come a-tumbling down." There's a bottleneck or bottlenecks in our supply chain, right? We've all heard about that. Cargo ships moored out in the harbors waiting to come in. There aren't enough truck drivers, not enough trucks. When the walls come a-tumbling down. Businesses having to shorten operating hours or beg for patience and understanding of their customers when service is slow. Because it seems that there's no one applying for work. When the walls come a-tumbling down. Oh, I know that the stock market continues to go bonkers. It's at near all-time high, right? And for those of us whose livelihoods are linked somehow to how the stock market is doing, we're doing better than ever. But I also remember 2008. And I'm wondering, I don't think I'm alone. I'm wondering and I'm worrying a bit when that market is going to crash. When the walls come a-tumbling down. Jesus got his disciples' attention. Jesus really got his disciples' attention when he said, "Not one stone will be left upon another." And I believe that he's getting our attention today as well. Because most everything that we cling to, that we hold on to, that we are that we cling to dearly can be taken away, can vanish, can be lost in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. So I think the first message that we need to hear from this text today is that there's no real security in anything. There's no real security in anything but in Jesus. So we cling to Jesus. Jesus is the only security. Place your hope there. Place your trust there. Place your future there, your anticipation there. Isn't that why we come to worship on a regular basis? To be reminded of that? That in the midst of all the uncertainty, there is one certainty, and that's Jesus. And isn't that why, really, when after we've come to worship and during worship and at other times, we decide that this message of the unconditional love of God in Jesus Christ, this sure message, is something that needs to continue to be proclaimed. And so it's something that we support generously. Yeah, people need to hear this. I need to hear this week in and week out. You need to hear this week in and week out. Other people need to hear this week in and week out because the walls do crumble. But faith in Jesus lasts forever. So the first thing we need to hear today is that there's no real security except in Jesus. The second thing I believe that we need to hear today is actually a message of hope. Hope. Doesn't really sound like it in our text, but let me get there. Let me get at it this way. When a gazillion years ago, when I was a junior in college, I lived and studied in West Germany. And when I was there, I had the opportunity to go to Berlin. Now, at that time, Berlin was a split city. There was a wall going right down the center of it. And while I could go through Checkpoint Charlie, go through, see East Berlin, where they got all these historic buildings, but the thing is, what a difference between East and West. The West was prospering, lights and lots of activity, and the East, quieter, drab, dark. Now, I had the opportunity to go back through the checkpoint over to West Berlin, right? But those residents of East Berlin could not go to the other side. 2 years after I had studied in Germany, the wall came a tumbling down. It was the first step in the reunification of East and West Germany to now what we know as Germany. It was the birthing, if you will, of a new nation with renewed hope. And I share that because though the walls come a tumbling down can be an ominous image, it kind of is, it can also be an image of hope. And hope is what I believe that Jesus had in mind when he predicted the fall or the destruction of the temple. Hope, even in the midst of the chaos. And here's why I think that. Jesus said that of all the chaos predicted for Jerusalem, this is but the beginning of the birth pangs. The birth pangs. Like the destruction of the Berlin Wall signaled the birth of something new, Jesus says that something new will come. And that something new is life. It's not the end. You see, this type of literature that you find here and there in Scripture, and certainly in the last book of the Bible, as well as Ezekiel and Daniel, it's called apocalyptic literature. And it sounds really really scary, like your dog's going to become the devil, right? It sounds scary. And on the one hand, it is. But that's not the big purpose of apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic literature is to give a word of hope, a word of hope in the midst of the chaos. It's not meant to only scare the pants off of us, but rather it's to give us hope. Not in the stuff of the world, no, no, but in the God of Jesus Christ, even as it seems like the walls may be coming down. A story. There was once a volunteer tutor who was asked to go to the hospital to visit a 9-year-old boy in his hospital room to work on nouns and adverbs. Tutor got to the hospital and then realized that this boy was in the burn unit. It's a nasty place. I mean, it's a beautiful place of the care, but burns, it's a lot. Well, the tutor, got her courage up and she walked in and she introduced herself and she did say, "I'm here to help you work on nouns and adverbs." The next morning, the tutor got a call from a nurse from the hospital, and that nurse said, "What did you do to that boy?" And after beginning a tearful apology, the nurse interrupted her and said, No, you don't understand. We've been worried about him. But since you were here, he's beginning to fight back. He's responding to treatment. It's as though he's decided to live." The boy later explained that he'd given up on hope till that tutor came. "I figured they wouldn't send a tutor to work on nouns and adverbs with a kid who's dying, would they?" Now that's hope. That's hope even when the walls are crumbling down. Hope that chaos and crisis are not the last word, and they're not. We believe that God gets the last word, and that last word from God is a word of life, new life, life being birthed, being brought forth, even in the midst of chaos. Now, this text about chaos, struggle, and destruction might not just be about you and me and learning that we're to cling to Jesus and there's hope. It might actually be about Jesus. It might be foreshadowing what's going to happen to Jesus because this is the Gospel of Mark. This is the story of Jesus, is it not? So right after this 13th chapter of Mark comes chapters 14 and 15. Now you can all say, duh. But in chapters 14 and 15, what we have there is the story of Jesus' betrayal, his mock trial, his torture, and his execution. It certainly seemed like the walls were coming a-tumbling down. But then after chapters 14 and 15, we get to chapter 16, right? In chapter 16, we get to resurrection. We get to Easter. We get to new life, and we can understand that chapters 13 and 14 and 15 were but the beginnings of the birth pangs. Life was being birthed in the resurrection. Life for you. Life free from the burdens of sin. Life filled with hope that God does indeed have the last word. Life, even in the midst of struggle and pain. I hope I've put, it's an idiom, David. What's something to do with an worm, earworm. Earworm? Is that what it's called? Yeah, whatever that's called. I hope that you today, for the rest of the day, keep on hearing John Cougar Mellencamp singing, "When the Walls Come A-Tumbling Down." And I hope as you do so, you'll remember what we're talking about in this text, that how this text all fits together for you, but also for Jesus. I hope John Cougar Mellencamp's song reminds you that our only true security is Jesus. And I hope that song, as it's haunting you today, maybe this whole week, will remind you that you might have your eyes opened, that you might experience, that you might actually experience that new life being birthed in you and around you. For it's new life that Jesus has come to bring. Amen. Let's stand and sing. Number 860. Let's pray. God, our Creator, you show us the path of life. Bless faithful people everywhere with humility as they extend compassion to those who have experienced harm in religious spaces. Cultivate healthy congregations that tell of and enact your reconciling love. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our constant, you love our universe from beginning to end. As the seasons change, protect animals that migrate and hibernate. Bring them safely to a sheltered place in a more abundant season. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our ruler, you write your law on human minds and hearts. Give wisdom to all elected leaders and officials to govern with insight and compassion. Make them mindful of the well-being of all people so that your world will flourish. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our stronghold, you are present amid disasters when the walls are coming tumbling down. We pray for those affected by natural disasters. Come to the aid of all survivors of earthquakes, famines, floods, hurricanes, and wildfires, and the first responders who support them. Calm their fear, supply their need, and be the solid ground beneath their feet. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our guide, you are greater than we can imagine. Surround congregations with your expansive inclusion. Be present in the midst of disagreements, differences, and questions. Unite people of diverse viewpoints in the love of Christ. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our beginning and our end, your beloved people shine like the brightness of the sky. We thank you for the lives of all who rest in your eternal mercy, from famous saints to the people we have loved. Assure us of your resurrection promise. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our hope and strength, we entrust to you all for whom we pray. Remain with us always, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. It is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. For those of you worshiping at home, now is the time to gather your bread and your wine or grape juice. Taking your bread, eat it as you hear the words, "The body of Christ given for you." And now taking your wine or grape juice, drink as you hear the words, "The blood of Christ shed for you." For those of you in the sanctuary, there will be two stations in the front. Whoever's a volunteer to serve communion, you can come and get ready at this time. There'll be two stations at the front center. We start with the center sections at the front. You come down. Those of you communing, please take either a piece of bread. Go ahead. Of bread, or there's gluten-free crackers available as well. You'll hear the words, "The body of Christ given for you." So you take that out of the tray. You eat that immediately, and then you'll have the opportunity to take either a small glass of red wine or white grape juice. You'll hear the words, "The blood of Christ shed for you." Go ahead and drink that and place your empty cups in the wooden bowls here. And when you're done communing, everyone else can come down the center aisle also. Same process. We continue now with communion.
God will not falter.
invite you to stand for the blessing. And now may the blessing of God and the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace and his truth and his life now and forever. Amen.
Peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.